Listen for the word of God. Peace on earth. This Christmas season finds us a rather bewildered human race. We have neither peace within nor peace without. Everywhere, paralyzing fears harrow people by day and haunt them by night. Our world is sick with war. Everywhere we turn, we see its ominous possibilities. And yet, my friends, the Christmas hope for peace and goodwill towards all men can no longer be dismissed as a kind of pious dream of some utopian. If we don't have goodwill toward men in this world, we will destroy ourselves by the misuse of our own instruments of our own power. Wisdom born of experience should tell us that war is obsolete. There may have been a time when war served as a negative good by preventing the spread and growth of an evil force, but the very destructive power of modern weapons of warfare eliminates even the possibility that war may any longer serve as a negative good. And so, if we assume that life is worth living, if we assume that mankind has a right to survive, then we must find an alternative to war. And so let us this morning explore the conditions for peace. Let us this morning think anew on the meaning of that Christmas hope, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. And as we explore these conditions, I would like to suggest that modern man really go all out to study the meaning of nonviolence, its philosophy, and its strategy. It really boils down to this, that all life is interrelated. We are all caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied into a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. We are made to live together because of the interrelated structure of reality. Now let me say that the next thing we must be concerned about if we are to have peace on earth and goodwill toward men is the nonviolent affirmation of the sacredness of all human life. Every man is somebody because he is a child of God. And so when we say thou shalt not kill, we're really saying that human life is too sacred to be taken on the battlefields of the world. Man is more than a tiny vagary of whirling electrons or a wisp of smoke from a limitless smoldering. Man is a child of God made in his image and therefore must be respected as such. Until men see this everywhere, until nations see this everywhere, we will be fighting wars. One day, somebody should remind us that in Christ there is neither Jew nor Gentile. In Christ there is neither male nor female. In Christ there is neither communist nor capitalist. In Christ, somehow, there is neither bound nor free. We are all one in Christ Jesus. And when we truly believe in the sacredness of human personality, we won't exploit people. And we won't trample over people with the iron feet of oppression. And we won't kill anybody. I still have a dream that brotherhood will be more than a few words at the end of a prayer, but rather the first order of business on every legislative agenda. Christ came to show us the way. Men love darkness rather than the light. And they crucified him. And there on Good Friday, on the cross, it was still dark. But then Easter came, and Easter is an eternal reminder of the fact that the truth, crushed down to earth, will rise again. Easter justifies Carlyle in saying, "No lie can live forever." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my voice and the meditations of all of our souls be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In our work with Dr. King this year, we have found it to be arguably as valuable as almost anything in the Bible. Certainly, it is more useful than, say, Habakkuk. I think we have discovered together is that Dr. King's lessons pour off the page with a vivid clarity and a burning lucidity that calls us to awaken to our vital, spiritual, and ethical core and bring it to bear on the injustices we see in our world and in our time. His work is alive and as appropriate to our times as it was in the hour in which it was written. Dr. King has prescience, or the knowledge of things or events before they exist or before they happen, because he has foresight. Now, this is not a magic ability to see into the future. It is, however, the prophetic ability to understand where the course of human events is headed. The sermon he wrote itself could be covered in several sermons, maybe an Advent series next year. So I've made the whole thing available in the narthex on a table. I will here only describe a couple pertinent segments, leaving the rest for the avid disciples of the word to discover on your own. It's a Christmas sermon, and Dr. King starts with the great yearning that we have every year for peace on earth. If we want peace on earth, we have to take the idea seriously as something that can actually happen and not treat it as some hopeless aspiration that only a utopian dreamer would indulge in. We have to study peace the way we study war and understand how much money is arrayed against peacemaking and how much is invested in war making. And we cannot just advocate for that peace, we must be that peace. In the same way that if you want to have a great honeymoon, you have to be a great honeymoon. We have to be that peace. When Dr. King delivered this sermon in 1967, 500,000 American soldiers were in Vietnam. And we were dropping more bombs on them than all the bombs dropped by everyone put together in World War II. We killed 3 million Vietnamese. That's half a Holocaust. Dr. King had come out against the war in Vietnam, and though history would prove him to be utterly and deeply right in this stance, it made him a very unpopular person in the United States, even in the black community. Many people thought he should stick to being a civil rights leader. But King saw how black men were being disproportionately drafted and sent into battle and killed. He also saw that the war itself was unjustified. And beyond that, all wars must be examined closely and questioned deeply if a war is to be justified at all. And at this point in time, Dr. King sadly observes, the world is sick with war. It is true in our own time that the longest war in our history continues unabated with no end in sight. And we maintain 800 military bases around the world. We are always at war now. Our world, too, is sick with war. So peace on earth is not just a nice idea, a utopian dream, but it may be the only way forward. The conditions of creating peace require nonviolence as a theology and as a way of being. and a working knowledge of how it can be accomplished is necessary. Our loyalties must transcend our divisions. We must not be as Presbyterian as we are ecumenical, and not be so much Christian as interfaith, not be so much religious as loving. We must work to come together in everything we do because we must live together as sisters and brothers or perish together as fools. We live in connection if we are to have any life at all. We are all caught in an inescapable network of mutuality tied into a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. That is the interrelated structure of reality. Now, we cannot get to peace through anything but peaceful means. Peace is both the way and the destination, the end and the means. And the ends of peace can only be arrived at through the means of peace. In the final analysis, means and ends must cohere because the end is pre-existent in the means. And ultimately, destructive means cannot bring about constructive ends. For example, President Johnson spoke eloquently about peace every time he dropped bombs on North Vietnam. We keep hearing that battle forces are called peacekeeping troops. Can peace be achieved through war? War is peace. That's a very Orwellian concept. It's a phrase from George Orwell's 1984 is critiqued on the webpage Literary Devices. This phrase, war is peace, is one of the three slogans of the party. The slogans are war is peace, freedom is slavery, and ignorance is strength. The party believed that they could endlessly engage in war to keep peace in the country. This slogan describes the reality of accepting two mutually opposing beliefs simultaneously as correct. This was also a major program of the party to promote double thinking. Hence, it is a good example of double thinking. And though contradictory, the people of Oceania accepted both ideas as correct. Double thinking then blocks us from understanding what is happening. It stops our brain cold, and we have to think our way around it. So the idea that an ever bigger defense budget will keep us safe is a fallacy. That putting guns in classrooms will make our students safer is a grotesque falsehood. That a constant state of war in the Middle East will somehow make the people there love us and bring them peace and democracy is false on its face. Therefore, peace is not a distant goal we seek. It is the very means by which we will achieve that goal. If there is to be peace on earth and goodwill toward men, we must finally believe in the ultimate morality of the universe and believe that all reality hinges on moral foundations. Something must remind us of this as we once again stand in the Christmas season and think of the Easter season simultaneously. For the two somehow go together. And Good Friday must come before Easter. Now, there are some deadly examples in the news recently about how we do not act as if life is sacred. What are some of the ways that life is being diminished as a result of actions by different parts of our government? Here are several. One, the bill to extend Agent Orange benefits and Vietnam vets died in the Senate. The bill would make tens of thousands of ailing veterans eligible for disability compensation and health care from the Veterans Administration. Two, a 50-year-old computer system at the Veterans Administration collapsed, delaying benefits. About 450,000 veterans have been affected. One veteran said, I can't afford rent. I can't afford groceries. It's a lot of emotional strain and aggravation. Veterans are becoming homeless, losing their homes because the benefits are late. 3, there are 20 veterans who commit suicide every day, and they are being ignored. Counseling staffs and budgets are not being increased. This has been the rate for years now. 4, the Atlantic magazine has noted the administration has now decided that Vietnamese immigrants who arrived in the country before the establishment of diplomatic ties between the United States and Vietnam are subject to standard immigration law, meaning they are all eligible for deportation. Winnie Wong, a progressive organizer, offered a succinct translation of the proposed policy change. They want to deport Vietnamese grannies who have been living here for more than 40 years. ICE has also deported a South Korean girl who was adopted by an American veteran serving there. 5, the administration is considering cutting $100 million worth of crucial medical research into developing new vaccines and treating diseases like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. 6, a 7-year-old Guatemalan girl died in the custody of the Border Patrol. She died of dehydration after receiving no treatment or water in the 8 hours that she was in custody with a fever of 105. The death of the 7-year-old comes after a toddler died in May, just after being released from an ICE family detention facility in Texas. The families are being blamed for bringing their kids on this trek across 2,000 miles. But it doesn't take long to figure out that you have to be pretty desperate to save your child, to set out on a journey like that. The distance is the same as walking from here to New York City and back. 7, the Southern Poverty Law Center reports Santos Chirino said he would be murdered if he was deported. He was deported anyway, and 6 months later, he was murdered. There are now more than 60 stories like this. Now his 18-year-old daughter and 19-year-old son are pleading their own case. This is how deportation can literally be a death sentence. These are examples of how we, as a nation, do not treat all human life as sacred. These are lives that are being dispensed with as if they were so much leftover sawdust. Dr. King said, "When we say thou shalt not kill, we're really saying that human life is too sacred to be taken on the battlefields of the world. Man is more than a tiny vagary of whirling electrons or a wisp of smoke from limitless smoldering. Man is a child of God, made in his image, and therefore must be respected as such. The lives that are dispensed with at our borders, or the suicidal veterans, or the victims of opioid overdoses, or people with illnesses they cannot pay for, are falling in the battlefield of our nation's indifference." What we have been saying about justice is also true of peace. Peace does not exist in nature. We have to create it. We have to advocate for the truth of it, that in this truth-challenged world, we have to make the case again and again. Truth crushed down to earth will rise again. That is what resurrection is about. We have to create the conditions for peace, make sure it is a priority, and then see it through. But I have to confess, I am having my own trouble finding peace in this season. I become angrier and angrier when I read about each of these incidents, each of these preventable crimes, each outrage that is not a matter of accident or mistake, but are intentional and deliberate instances of heartless policy. I see people who cannot defend themselves getting the boot of the state brought down upon their necks. And I am filled with anger that begins to border on hate. And I know that I have to love my enemy. Dr. King said it best, "I've decided to stick with love. Hate is too great a burden to bear." When you rise to love on this level, you love all men, not because you like them, not because their ways appeal to you, but you love them because God loves them. This is what Jesus meant when he said, love your enemies. And I'm happy to say, I'm happy that he didn't say, like your enemies. Because there are some people that I find to be pretty difficult to like. It's a Dr. King quote. I love that one. I'm happy he didn't say, like your enemies, because there are some people that I find pretty difficult to like. In other words, for me, I am not good enough, nor strong enough, nor loving enough to get to loving these enemies on my own. I cannot rise to that level without the help of God. I cannot love these people doing these heinous things without the love of God lifting me beyond my own capacity to love. Without the love of God for those people, reminding me to love them as well. To share the love that I have received as a gift and give it away so that the peace we create with them becomes the peace that I can carry into my own heart and my own world as I myself move into the Christmas season. I cannot do that on my own. But if I am to have peace on earth, I have to make that peace. And if I am making that peace, I am confident that I am doing God's will. And that makes it worth a try. Let us pray. Dear God, whose love for us is beyond our own understanding, help us to overcome the darkness in this world by growing your light in our own hearts. As the nights are now as long and as dark as they ever get, help us to connect to the light that is slowly returning. Help us to light a candle rather than curse the darkness. All this we ask in your name. Amen.